Thanks very much. Yeah, so I'm going to do this today in two parts. I wrote a book called Little Rice, Smartphone, Xiaomi, and the Chinese Dream about the company Xiaomi. I wrote it in 2014 and 2015 at a time when Xiaomi had sort of burst onto the global scene. I want to talk about essentially what I, a lot of what I said in the book. And then in the second part, I want to talk a little more speculatively. This is more open-ended without slides. About what we can learn from Xiaomi, and particularly what it says about China and Chinese internet services. There was a lot of conversation about WeChat. There was a lot of conversation about Alibaba, Alipay, these internet giants within the Chinese internet landscape. And the conclusion I came to in researching the Xiaomi book is that the constraints imposed by the Chinese government on those companies are a bigger competitive disadvantage than people have factored in. There's currently a sort of bromance story between Silicon Valley and Zhongguancun, which is the neighborhood in Beijing, which is basically the Silicon Valley of China. And I think that there's more of a separation between these two spheres of internet activity rather than a convergence or emerging, as seemed to be the case a few years ago. So I'll talk first about the book and about Xiaomi, and then move on to a little more open-ended on Chinese internet services, and then assume that we'll have something to talk about at the end. So Xiaomi. Xiaomi is a phone company that was founded in 2010. It was founded to make smartphones. They've never not made an Android phone. They were one of the first companies that was founded to do that and that only. Why is it a big deal? Well, Xiaomi was a big deal because by 2014, they had climbed so far up the list, really from nowhere, that they were starting to displace really major phone manufacturers. And by the end of 2014, particularly on Singles Day, which is the big online shopping day in China, 11/11, the 11th day of November is their Black Friday, as it were, most of the phones sold on the Alibaba e-commerce platform were Xiaomi phones, a single company. So they really came from founding to dominating the list of mobile phone manufacturers in the world's largest market in less than 4 years. By the end of that year, they were valued at about $45 billion, which made them, for a brief period of time, the most valuable startup that had ever happened. They were subsequently replaced by Uber in the following year, but at the time that I was writing the book, they had become the most valuable startup in the world. I didn't tune into Xiaomi because of this. This happened actually after I started watching them. I tuned into Xiaomi because of this. I moved to Shanghai a few years ago. NYU was opening a four-year campus there. I'm helping build an interactive media arts department there, modeled on the one that NYU has in New York. And I needed a phone. And I did the thing you do if you're a foreigner in a city you don't know well, is I got lost in the subway. And I got out at what I thought was my subway stop. And I thought it was my subway stop because I got out into the basement of a mall, which describes about a third of the subway stops in Shanghai. And I didn't really understand that the subway stop and the mall that I was in was not my subway stop and my mall. So I was wandering around confused. And I did the thing that people who design confusing malls want you to do, which is I slowed down and I looked around because I was trying to orient myself. And there was a booth selling phones there. And I thought, well, that black one looks nice. I need a phone. I don't have a Chinese phone yet. And so, OK, how much? This is that. And I walk away with this, which is a Mi 3. I get back on the subway. I go back the one stop to the stop I should have gotten out at. I get out. I walk to the NYU campus. I need to do something or other. I take the phone out of my pocket. And one of our Chinese students says, where did you get that? They didn't say, what kind of phone is that? They knew the minute it came out of my pocket what it was. They said, where did you get that? And basically, what is a foreigner doing with one of those phones? So I asked why. And this phone, at the time I got it, was sold out in all of China. Xiaomi only sells online. They had run out. Someone had bought them and was reselling them in a physical booth. And I happened to luck across this one phone. And believe me, at my age, being the envy of teenagers is not a familiar experience before or since. But for a brief period of time, when I had this, people were like, oh, that guy's paying attention. which is ironic because, in fact, I wasn't paying attention. I had the phone completely accidentally, but I knew that there was something special about this. So instead of just treating it as a commodity phone, it's a nice Android phone, you can use it, it works well, it's nicely designed, I started tuning into the company. And the rhetoric around Xiaomi at the time, this is mid-2013, is this is China's Apple. Right? This is the company that is bringing Apple-style innovation to China. So when Columbia University started an imprint called Global Reports, I wrote to the editor and I said, you know, I've just moved to China. There's this interesting company. It's called Xiaomi. They're doing this stuff. I'm going to pay attention to them. Maybe there's something there. And they said, sounds great. Send us a proposal. And off we go. So I started paying attention to Xiaomi. And what became quickly apparent is that although they, as a design company, they're quite nice, what's really important about Xiaomi is that they'd figured out how to innovate outside of the hardware ecosystem. We've all gone to school so much on how Apple computer works that people have been instructed to believe that innovation is hardware innovation. And there's so much obsession about the hardware. What Xiaomi's actually done is innovated almost everything else around the mobile phone ecosystem. And while they have stylishly designed phones that don't look like anything else, like the Mi 3, other phones, especially right now the Mi 4 and the Mi 5, their two later models, are basically clones of the iPhone. But that doesn't mean that Xiaomi isn't innovative. It just means that the innovation isn't in the hardware. In fact, what Xiaomi realized is it's a screen of black glass, right, with one button at the bottom and a power button someplace else. How hard can it be? What Xiaomi has done that has transformed the Android ecosystem is they made a bunch of bets every place else. So I'm going to talk about those bets, and I'm going to group them into two categories. They made two big bets. The first big bet was just timing. Xiaomi, as I said, was founded in 2010, and they said, we're never not going to make a smartphone. We will only make an Android smartphone as our base product. To show you what an unusual but also a prescient bet this was, here's the chart. Oops, sorry, there is Xiaomi, and there are the founders. Happy Lei Jun in the middle, the CEO. But here is the chart of mobile operating system adoption in China. The green line is Nokia, and you can see that in the middle, even as late as the middle of 2010, two-thirds of the phones sold in China are still Nokia brick phones. The iPhone is not for sale yet in China. Nokia was basically betting the farm. When the curve looked like this, Nokia said, well, it took a little market share, and now we're on this long, slow decline, and we have lots of time to adapt. Technological change comes to China two ways, late, then fast. Within 12 months, two-thirds of the phones sold were Android phones. There is no country in the world where the crossover from brick phones to Android phones or to smartphones in general happened faster than China. Xiaomi launches here. So their first big bet, which has essentially got them in the neighborhood of success, was China is switching, and it's switching quickly. And if we have that product, we will ride that. The second big bet, and it's unusual for a Chinese hardware company to do this, is they bet on the internet. And they bet on the internet everywhere. And this is essentially, much of the book is about how this bet played out. For instance, although they are a company that's known for hardware, they did not ship an actual phone for over a year after launch. What they built first was the operating system, because they realized that for any sufficiently complicated technology, the interface is the product from the user's point of view. So they took stock Android and started modifying it to make it run well on Samsung phones. They borrowed other people's hardware. And they would make a modification, and then they would ask their users, how did it go? And they would make another modification, and they would ask their users, how did it go? And to get any user testing at all, they had to basically convince people to risk bricking their phone to install these ROMs. And they did that operating system feedback for over a year before they shipped their first piece of hardware, which for most hardware companies is backwards. You start with the hardware and then you add the operating system. And the operating system is almost always added as a kind of afterthought. There's some decoration of it. You know what Android looks like. It looks like stock Android plus a few custom icons. They went after battery life. They went after faster performance. And they got people who owned quite expensive Samsung phones to say, my phone works better when I'm running the Xiaomi operating system, called MIUI, than when I'm running Samsung. Another example of their bet on the internet. Every time the user updates their software, they're invited to tweet it out. They put it out on Weibo, which is basically China's version of Twitter. But they're invited to send a message to the public. So what in most companies is treated as a completely plumbing-oriented operation, you downloaded some new bits and you loaded them onto the phone, is here an opportunity for marketing. They don't do traditional marketing. They don't buy TV ads. They don't do bus wraps. Their users market their products. User-to-user recommendations are more powerful than anything the company would tell you. In their shop in Beijing, they have a marketing staff which includes programmers who are doing nothing but writing tools to help them manage their social media presence. And these comments go up. These comments are from 2010 and 2011. And they're all from users who put this stuff on their phones that Xiaomi didn't make. Sometimes the comments are not even uniformly positive. But Xiaomi can't control that. They knew they wouldn't be able to control it anyway. And they say users talking about us is better than users not talking about us, even if it's a mixed bag. Right. Third big bet, they only sell online. They don't risk the decay of the parts going out of stock, of having stock in one place and not having stock in another place. You have to buy it online. This created two big advantages for them. One, they don't have to worry about shipment to a lot of little stores. But two, it allowed them to be able to say to vendors, we know in advance how much demand there's going to be, because we just told people there were going to be 10,000 phones and 100,000 people signed up for them. So they could walk into Shenzhen, the giant electronics market, looking for screens or looking for cases. And they could say, you should give us the million unit price because we know we have that much demand. And so early on, they drove the price that you usually coast up when you start shipping 10,000, then 100,000, then a million units. They could go in and get the million unit price because they knew in advance from the online sales what the demand was going to be. It also meant anybody selling the phones in stores like China Telecom had to eat the risk and the decay. Electronics parts decay in value by about 2% a week. Which means if you don't sell a phone over the course of a month, you've taken a 1/20th hit on your margin relative to what you could have done. So they bet big on e-commerce. And again, this bet was in 2010. We know now that e-commerce in China with Jack Ma's companies, Alibaba, Taobao, and so on, have had a huge effect. But Lei Jun and his team were skating to where the puck was going to be. And then here's the biggest one, and I think the biggest surprise, is they involved their users in the co-development of this operating system early on. It wasn't just download this and install this on your Samsung. It was download this, install it on your Samsung, give us feedback. They ship a new version of the operating system every week. They have done that since 2010. They do it week in and week out. Here is the schedule. Every Friday, they release. The following Tuesday, they solicit feedback. Violating this schedule is the crisis. This schedule is the low energy state in Xiaomi. Build, ship, analyze, build. They go to their users every week. There's a small group of users who are technically intense, and they will get significant feedback from them. There's a much larger group of users that they only ask four questions of. What'd you like? What didn't you like? What was your overall feeling when you installed this? What else should we do? A third of the features in the operating system now come from that fourth question. A third of the features that Xiaomi ships were things like the users saying, I hate it when I get spam calls. Xiaomi has built, there is no do not call registry in China. Xiaomi has built their own registry of scam numbers. So when your phone rings, it will tell you in advance if it's a scam. And you just don't answer it. Right? A private company can do that because they have so much data coming in from so many users. And here you can see that they've just aggregated the recommendation rate for loading or reloading the operating system. Should you or should you not do this? And again, they're willing to broadcast the idea that a group of expert users recommends that ordinary users don't load this ROM. So they have been very serious about not just collecting feedback, but allowing it to get out into the public. They started, famously, with 100 users. They started, it was a hardware company that didn't have a hardware product. They also recruited users before they had a software product. They went around to Android bulletin boards and they found people who knew about, cared about Android, were talking about it online. And they recruited 100 people to risk bricking their phones in order to test this. And they bootstrapped from there, more users, it got easier to install. They finally were shipping hardware with the software. And they recently got to 100 million users, which is not bad for a flavor of Android, a particular flavor of Android. But in the first paragraph of the press release, where they're talking about getting getting to their 100 million users, they specifically thank the first 100 users. A lot of companies pay lip service to this idea of user feedback because in the 21st century, it sounds like the thing you ought to care about, even though most companies don't actually care about it. Xiaomi consistently remembers the people who took a risk when they started shipping this operating system. So, as I said, the principal advantage that Xiaomi had was not in fancy new hardware. There are no features of the phone that would surprise anyone who's ever used any other Android phone. It is, as I said, a slab of black glass. It's got one button in the front. It's got a power button top or side. The icons are pretty much what you expect. They're especially nice. There's some new features. But there's nothing in the hardware itself that's terribly special. What they did do was to clear out a competitive space that people didn't believe existed. Right? The market is supposed to sort itself into there's a luxury product and there's a commodity product. And you either have to go to mass or you have to go to margin. What Xiaomi said is, if we hire good enough designers and we amortize the cost over a large enough base, we can produce a phone that the middle of the market will think is either surprisingly good for the price or surprisingly cheap for the quality. And we'll get people converging to the middle from both sides. And against everyone else's bet, that worked incredibly well. Xiaomi could only get there by innovating significantly across the company, but again, not in the hardware. Where Xiaomi innovated was to say, we're not dealing with physical stores. We're not dealing with warehousing. We're not dealing with, we're not dealing with traditional marketing. We're upgrading our operating system based on consistent user feedback. Xiaomi bet on openness. They bet on internet participation. They bet on treating every aspect of sales and service other than making the physical phone itself as something that needed to be virtualized. One of their sources of innovation is that they have insourced customer service. They run their own call center out of Beijing. They prefer to do it by online chat. They prefer to do it electronically, digitally, but they will not let anyone else talk to Xiaomi customers about Xiaomi products. They regard that as a critical competitive advantage rather than just a cost to be reduced. So what Xiaomi demonstrated was that if you innovated everything around making the phone, you're an innovative company, even if people can't say that's an innovative product. And that's, I think, one of the things that people have missed in looking to China, is they expect to see Apple-style hardware launches. And Lei Jun attracted some of that. He would wear a black turtleneck and jeans. You know, it's sort of the style that's expected of CEOs of big design companies. But in fact, Xiaomi's innovation is elsewhere. Many Americans missed that. The Chinese did not miss that. So 2014, the year in which I was writing the book, was the best year that Xiaomi ever had, because that was the last year in which anyone underestimated them. By the end of 2014, when they had become the most valuable startup in the world, Everyone had tuned in. 2015 was the year that Xiaomi showed everyone how it was done. And sadly for them, 2016 is the year that everyone is now doing it that way. So at the end of the book, I say, what are the risks to Xiaomi given this incredible success? There are basically two. One is competition, the other is government intervention. In competition, the risk was, now that Xiaomi has demonstrated what innovation looks like around the manufacture of a mobile phone and an operating system, how easy or hard will that be to copy? I didn't know at the time. I knew that it would be somewhat easy to copy. What I didn't expect is what happened, which is that it turned out that doing what Xiaomi was doing, even a little bit, was enough to kick other phone companies into high gear. So this headline from this year, 10 mobile phone companies changing the industry. Coolpad, Johnny, Huawei, Meizu, OnePlus, Oppo, some existing phone companies have modified themselves. Some new phone companies have come into being. Meizu's basic business plan is we're going to do to Xiaomi what Xiaomi did to Samsung, and they've done it. Xiaomi is now number four in its own market because the other companies have come along and actually found space below Xiaomi where they can do this same good for the price, surprisingly high quality, good for the price, surprisingly high quality for the price, surprisingly good design. And the whole Chinese mobile phone ecosystem has now simply kicked into a higher clock speed. This is incredibly bad news for companies like HTC and Lucky Gold, who don't really have any place to go in the mid-market. HTC is in Taiwan, Lucky Gold is in Korea. It will eventually be bad news for Samsung, who has essentially been transformed into a luxury manufacturer because they can't do the cost. Xiaomi has really turned Apple into a luxury manufacturer. I mean, the rose gold color of the Apple phone is basically an admission that what you're paying for is evidence that you can afford a rose gold phone, right? Apple will never get out from under that. And you can see the difference here. Android, there are now over a billion Android users. Apple may never get to a billion iOS users on any platform. And when you look at the list, if you go to the list of mobile phone manufacturers, there are about 100 and some odd, 100 and a few listed on GSM Arena. The bulk of them are in China. China is where the action is, partly because they have the very tight loop of hardware ecosystem in Shenzhen, but partly because the Chinese companies have learned how to do this good enough design for the price, cheap enough price for the quality model. Every place that isn't China is now in more competitive trouble than they were 2 years ago because Xiaomi has shown everyone how it's done. And of course, the great irony of this is now the center of smartphone manufacturing worldwide is in a country where the operating system is sponsored by a company whose core products are illegal. So the strange thing about the Android story in China is you cannot ship a phone with Google Apps installed, famously because the Chinese have blocked Google Apps. For a while, Xiaomi just shipped the Google Apps anyway, because as a lawyer once explained to me, in China there are things that are legal and there are things that are allowed, and they're different categories. And so for a while it was not legal, but it was allowed for Xiaomi to do this. Then they got a wrist slap. They said, okay, we're not going to do this, but we're going to point you to an installer. And slowly over time, even that has gone away. So Xiaomi now pays a fairly significant strategy tax for shipping two different versions of its operating system, one for China, one for rest of world. And in their last phone, the Mi 5, they ran into trouble because the first two times they tried to release a stable version of the Mi 5 ROM, it had so many bugs they had to pull it back. But pent-up demand was so great that scammers pretended they had a stable version of the global ROM. It was riddled with malware, but that was the number one result when you searched for it because enough people wanted it. So Xiaomi actually ended up exposing its own users to bad operating systems, bad versions of its operating system, because they couldn't pay the strategy tax of shipping both operating systems at the same time. So that brings me to the second part of this talk, which is this is a country that simultaneously outlaws and relies on global internet infrastructure. Xiaomi themselves runs a YouTube channel because you can't not if you want to sell phones worldwide. Americans often miss this because the companies I listed mostly don't sell phones in the United States or Northern Europe, but those aren't the growth markets anyway. The growth markets are Nigeria, they're Kenya, they're Brazil, they're the largely equatorial, rapidly developing markets that will buy cheaper phones but will not buy a rose gold iPhone. And so the question for the second half of this talk is really, what does it mean that you can't use YouTube in China, you can't use Google in China, you can't use Facebook in China, you can't use Twitter in China, but you can't be a global company if you don't have a presence on those platforms? So I'm going to switch now to talking about this a little bit. This is the second big threat that Xiaomi faces, but I'm going to do this a little differently since we're inside Google, the company most affected by this. I want to talk about it a little more generally. So to back up on this a little bit, there are basically three phases of regulation, of censorship and surveillance in China. One starts in the late 70s when China starts in what's universally called the opening up to world markets under Deng Xiaoping after Mao has passed away. And Mr. Deng has to navigate this huge transition from China as a command and control economy to China as at least a market open, if not market oriented economy. And so China tries a new thing. They say, instead of uniform lack of freedom in all dimensions for all citizens, which had been the norm under Mao, Mr. Deng says, we want to give citizens a relatively high degree of economic freedom, a moderate degree of personal freedom, which is very new, and no political freedom, because you can't stay a single party system if you give your citizens political freedom. But to everyone's surprise, including not least Mr. Deng, that worked. And there was enough economic freedom to pull China out, especially Shenzhen, the southern, what's now become the electronics district, was one of the engines that pulled 300 million Chinese out of poverty over the next 40 years. So that balance of high economic freedom, moderate personal freedom, low political freedom held. And there were even separate censorship regimes for each of those three areas. The business press was regulated one way, TV entertainment was regulated another way, and politics was regulated a third, much more aggressive way. So the internet shows up in the early 90s, and the Chinese have to answer this question. Which of these buckets does the internet go in? Is the internet mostly about economics? It's mostly about transactional information and learning things, finding out things for your business. Is the internet mostly cat pictures and stupid stuff that people will do to amuse themselves, but whatever, we don't care, as long as it's not political, it's fine? Or is the internet mostly about coordination in ways that might lead to the creation of a public sphere, a place where people air their significant opinions about the government? And the answer, of course, is yes. It's all of those things. You can't pick. And in fact, the internet makes it clear that the edges between those things are not even very clean. So the Chinese say, in order to maintain our internal censorship and propaganda regimes, we're just going to erect what is universally called the Great Firewall. Its official name is the Golden Shield Project, which will hive us off from the rest of the world. So they build the Great Firewall starting in the mid-1990s. And that stays stable for a little over a decade. And then things start to happen inside the Great Firewall. There was a horrific earthquake in Sichuan Province in 2008. The Chinese government has reserved for itself the right to deny that earthquakes happen. Even if the US Geological Survey reports it, it once took them in exactly the same region, it once took them 3 months to admit that there had been an earthquake. In the 2008 earthquake, they learned about it not from their own earthquake reporting or from the USGS. They learned about it from people taking pictures on their camera phones. The earthquake happened during the day, on a weekday. Schools collapsed, killing the children inside. Because of the one-child policy, a family that's lost their school-aged child has lost the next generation. So you suddenly have radicalized middle-class parents who have photographic evidence, and then they discover or have figured out that the school buildings collapsed because the people who built the buildings bribed the local officials to use substandard concrete. Everyone knew Sichuan province was an earthquake-prone zone. There were building standards to keep those buildings from collapsing, but they cost more. And so the corruption fairly directly killed the children. And a protest sprung up. It had nothing to do with information from the West. This had nothing to do with people reading the New York Times or whatever. And the Chinese began to grapple with the fact that what the Great Firewall was meant to defend against was no longer the threat. This is not widely appreciated. You often still see, when people write about the Great Firewall, you often still see people acting as if the threat to China is there's a GitHub repo of democracy, and if you could just download it and compile it locally, it will upset things. The threat that Chinese government faces now is not from a small number of well-known outlets that are professional and publish regularly. It's now from a large number of unknown citizens who publish ad hoc. And over again, there was a train crash in Wenzhou that was, again, documented in this pattern. The citizens documented it before the government even knew it happened. And the kickoff to this phase two was 2009, when in the aftermath of the Iranian uprising in June of that year, less widely appreciated, there was a sympathetic uprising among the Uyghur Muslim population, which is in China's west, in July of that year, that relied fairly heavily on Facebook, both for coordination and for documenting of the results. And China said, that's it. That's it for social media. Blocking Facebook, they later blocked Twitter. And they discovered, as people in this building know probably better than anybody in the world, that national security and trade barriers on the internet are very close to being the same thing. So China adopts a policy of hiving off any service that it feels is a threat from the rest of the world, and then sees as a result that same service or a service organized on those same principles grow up inside China. Right? So this is now the model that essentially creates Twitter and Weibo or Quora and Zhihu. There are these complementary services for almost anything outside China. There is a complementary service inside China. There are also services inside China that don't have big correlates in the rest of the world. There's a great deal of innovation around video, for example, that we don't have on our side of the firewall. But the worry the Chinese have is no longer about the Economist said something about us. They don't love that, and they block the Economist when it happens. The worry they have now is about platform access. They're much more concerned to block access to Medium and Blogger, and even Google Docs, than they are concerning about blocking the New York Times or the Economist. Because what they really don't want is for there to be a platform that Chinese citizens can use to talk to each other that they can neither surveil nor shut down. So this is now phase two. It starts in 2009. It has been growing in intrusiveness since then, which brings me now to this threat that Xiaomi faces. So Xiaomi, when they started in 2010, always announced that they wanted to be a services company. We ship the hardware at relatively near cost, but we acquire a customer. They continually update the software. They have never end-of-lifed a single product that they have shipped. Because if somebody wants to have a Xiaomi in their pocket, Xiaomi wants them to continue to do that as long as possible, rather than risk losing them to one of their competitors when they buy a new phone. The second half of that bet, though, is that they will be able to offer services to people who then provide essentially steady revenue from Xiaomi for using the platform. That has not panned out. It's not panned out well in China. It is especially not panned out globally, because people are becoming nervous about Chinese products. When Xiaomi shipped in Hong Kong, when they shipped in Singapore, when they shipped in India, people watched the phone traffic and they said, hey, this phone is making calls back to Beijing. And Xiaomi said, that's just quality control data. All we want to do is see how your phone is doing. This is to improve your phone. And people said, hey, this phone is talking back to Beijing. And Xiaomi realized, we can't make that argument. We can't have a phone that calls back to Beijing from Singapore or Hong Kong and have people comfortable with it. So what we're starting to see, and Xiaomi is to some degree a precursor of this, but WeChat is, I think, a bigger one. The story of innovation inside China, and particularly innovation around the mobile ecosystem, is exactly right. But many of those innovations are going to come outside China from being copied rather than spreading themselves. WeChat is a bad target for spread because WeChat's principal advantage is we do what Beijing wants us to do. That's the price of doing business in China. But that is a unique selling proposition in only one country in the world. And that inability for WeChat to say, we'll behave the way you expect us to behave in any country in the world except China, which is what Xiaomi has also tried, is very limited. It's much likelier that WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger will copy WeChat's features than that WeChat will spread. It's not clear what China will do about this. If you went to the current administration and you said you can have a more competitive services industry if you reduce the amount of control you have over what people say to each other, it's pretty clear that they would not take that bargain. But on a global stage, China's dilemma is this. China is bigger than anybody. If there was any country-to-country competition, China wins by default. It's the largest economy, it's got the most people, it's the most dynamic economy. India looks like a basket case compared to China, and they are the only ones with a similar population. But China is not bigger than everybody. And the environment they face, and really just in the last 2 or 3 years, is that there are now two companies that have more users in any given month than China has citizens. And that is new. That has never happened to China before. So the big question, which I open up a little bit at the end of the book, but it's become much clearer, is does the innovation that's going on in China escape by replication or by copying? Which is to say, are the bits moved from inside China to out, or do people simply learn from those patterns and build tools that do outside China what the Chinese do on the inside? I think the irony of copying Chinese models elsewhere without that benefiting the Chinese companies would be lost on no one. I know that the companies themselves very much want to be globally competitive, but the strategy tax being imposed by Beijing is growing rather than shrinking, and that's going to lead to a very interesting dynamic. I wish I could tell you what the result of that dynamic was. If I could, I would be writing another book, but I know that that's the dynamic we face. So I'll stop there and assume that there's something to talk about. So thanks very much. So I think we have time for some questions. Great. Great.
Oh, yeah, there's... So this isn't really a business question. It's just a mild question. But I noticed all your screenshots and everything were in English. I mean, do they do everything bilingually? Is there an assumption that you'd speak English?
They do everything. There's an assumption not that that you speak English. So there's a mix on some of the screenshots. I've tended to English because my audiences tend to read English. China is the biggest exporter of English as a second language because English solves the same problem for them that it solves for the EU, which is if you don't speak Mandarin and you don't read Chinese characters, your second language better be English because that's what we're doing the street signs in. So English is their main point of conversion, but the operating system ships in multiple languages and the website is, you know, they add more languages as they move. When they move to Brazil, they add Portuguese, et cetera. Because that picture I showed of the co-founders, they were all engineers. The engineering culture they live in is bilingual Mandarin and English. So Mandarin obviously is the language of the company, but English is the language of corporate communications. Other questions? Yes, sir.
So I know your forte at the moment is China, but you mentioned India, and I remember that Google tried to sell smartphones over the internet only. And in the end, we had to stop doing that and start selling them in physical stores. I was wondering if you had ideas about why that thing that worked very well in China did not work in India.
Yeah. So people go back and forth on this. And interestingly, that list I showed, Coolpad and Huawei and so forth, many people have adopted this sort of, it's a showroom model. You can walk into a Xiaomi experience center and you can walk away with a phone case, but not a phone, because they don't want the, you know, they don't want to warehouse the electronics. But a number of other companies like Huawei are starting to run stores. So it's still, it's, first of all, it's always a marginal question. You would only do internet sales if cost control beat every other impulse. And in Xiaomi's early days, cost control beat every other impulse. But the other thing is, the urbanization of China is quite extraordinary. So it hits different people from, you know, I now know that I live in a medium, you know, I spent the last 30 years in New York, and I now think of it as a medium-sized city with relatively squat buildings, because Shanghai is not like that. And it hits different people at different times. For me in Shanghai, the moment of, oh, this is different, was realizing the city I'd moved to had the same population as Australia, but at incredible urban density. And the Chinese care enormously about transportation systems. So the thing that Bezos is trying to develop, which is, oh, it'd be great if, you know, we could get a product right to you, we take that for granted in China. You order something on Taobao, there's a guy that gets on a motorbike and brings it to your front door. So the ability to say the gap between electronic sales and physical delivery is a well taken care of, relatively cheap, relatively effective delivery network, right, is something that most countries don't have. Other similarly urbanizing countries, such as Brazil, don't offer even Xiaomi the same opportunities. And they've had some trouble with that in Brazil. You know, there are obviously the famously dense cities in India are also famously congested. And so the ability to just get a consumer electronics product from point A to point B at high speed and low cost with nearly 100% reliability is a special characteristic that anyone doing e-commerce in China can rely on, but is not broadly replicable even to other countries in the region. Yes, sir.
Hi. So I think there are actually two ways of making the strategy tax be less. One of them would be for China to be freer. The other would be for the rest of the world to pull down into that level. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'm definitely seeing stuff like the whole fight about backdoored encryption. You don't want to allow people to recruit for ISIS online. That governments seem to all be sympathetic to the view that you want to control what people can see.
Right.
And I'm wondering, in terms of what China does, how different is it? How separate in degree? Is there any chance that the Western governments could move close enough that either China would close the gap or third parties would say US, China, same difference?
That is the huge risk. So in general, it's not good to compare the US to China because our systems are so different even from the Chinese systems. China could conceivably move to a more parliamentary system. It will never move to a sort of presidential system. But if you want to say European and rich Southeast Asian countries converging, that's the risk, right? If China becomes a net exporter of high-value censorship and surveillance that's low impact to the citizens' economic and personal behavior and only impacts their political behavior, because that's the key, right? China is not Romania. It's not a police state. They actually can't even hire enough traffic cops, much less, you know, a Stasi-like system. But they can monitor online very intensively. The risk is that Turkey signs up for this. South Korea, which has been making moves under Park to have a much higher degree of surveillance and intervention in politics, could sign up for some export of a censorship system. China does seem to be exporting pieces of its technology. The one thing that I find heartening, and I actually find more heartening living there than I did before I moved there, is that an unbelievable amount of Chinese censorship is manual. Literally people sitting in rooms watching Instagram photos go by. When the Hong Kong protests came along in 2014, Instagram just broke. It was still open in the country. Now it's been shut down. But you could still load the Instagram interface, but the photos wouldn't load because just the photos from Hong Kong, forget any of the political message, just evidence that people were turning out in the street was too threatening. And so the people who were looking at Instagram photos just got overwhelmed. So China has this triangle of very talented, of a large number of very talented, very cheap employees who can be put on a problem really in numbers like the millions. Turkey can't do that, Iran can't do that, even South Korea can't do that. The huge risk is if China manages to automate a large part of what's currently manual. Basically, if the AI problem is solved to the point that they could trust machines to take down images more. Because China doesn't want to shut down everything. They want, in fact, a very high flow of information. That is both, that makes people personally happy and it makes commerce go. But if they could, with machine intelligence, incisively reach in and just pull out those messages, that will become an exportable system. They're not there yet. But if we're going to be betting on machine learning breakthroughs here, those same machine learning breakthroughs will show up there. And that's the, as you say, there could be convergence in the direction of less freedom rather than more. Come here.
Yeah. Claire, you just discussed innovation for censorship.
Yep.
Can you tell us a bit more about, in the face of this, where is innovation to access the free and open internet from the inside come from, and what does it look like?
Yeah, so there's really two different kinds of innovation going on for the four people who want to have a freer conversation they're allowed to. One is around VPN technology, web proxies, the usual. People I know who work at Baidu, which is basically the people who have a job because you don't, are saying it's something like 3% of the population uses a VPN. VPNs are for largely for coastal elites. The Chinese are much less concerned with blocking data now than with desynchronizing its consumption. They don't try to keep all information out of the country that they don't like all the time. But if only a handful of elites read it and they don't read it all at the same time, they're not worried about it. So for instance, you can say almost anything you like in English. One of the reasons Quora is not blocked in China is that they have a very aggressive only use English on the site policy. No one asks and answers a question in Chinese. The day that that were to happen, Quora would go behind the firewall. And I know this as an advisor to a student newspaper that decided to publish bilingually and got blocked within a week. So the presence of Chinese language content is, you know, is one of those moments. So if you are a business, VPNs fall in the category of illegal but allowed. The Chinese can't allow them broadly because if everybody had a VPN, why have a firewall? The Chinese can't block them because if businesses can't advertise in the West, you can't globalize. And so VPNs are there's a kind of push me, pull you exercise. That's the stuff that many American activists, God bless their narcissistic little souls, are obsessed with, which is if only the Chinese could read The Economist, then China would suddenly, I don't know what they think would happen, but it's clearly ridiculous. The much more important innovation is the ability to have political conversations among the Chinese inside China. So no great firewall, but a high degree of watchfulness. And there are memes, there are puns, there are photos, they repurpose language. Famously, and I can't, I pronounce Mandarin like I pronounce English, which is with a flat Midwestern accent, but Kao Ni Ma says, it basically can either say grass, mud, horse, or fuck your mother. And they pronounce it grass, mud, horse, but the meaning comes across quite clearly to the party. River crabs, the phrase for river crabs, sound like harmonization, which is what the Chinese do when they're trying to wring political dissent out of the network. At one point, when Chen Guangchen, the blind lawyer who actually moved to New York, was still being held in China, they repurposed the Kentucky Fried Chicken logo, but put sunglasses on the colonel because he looked a little like Chen Guangchen. And that spread without people immediately being able to spot it. So in a way, it's like rooting for 4chan, which I know sounds strange, but it is the people producing the kind of oblique language. It's almost like a samizdat, where instead of it being the press that's hiding things, it's the nature of the message. And that is what matters. It's not about access to the West in terms of content, to the degree that there's a platform that matters. It's AWS and GitHub, which are the things that are hard to censor, but that China can't afford to shut off because too much business runs on it. But what will matter in China is the ability of people to have political conversations on social media, because the cost of shutting it down is too high. This is Ethan Zuckerman's cute cats theory of political dissent, which is the government can't, if you use a platform that's designed to be dissident, you know, dissident friendly, the government will just go after the whole platform. They'll block the ports, they'll look for the traffic. Any Tor traffic is evidence of malfeasance, you know, no matter what. If there's a platform where people are sharing pictures of the grandkids, the government can't shut that down without radicalizing the middle class. And that's where the action is. Not in these kind of we can hide and mask your conversation so you can secretly conspire against the state, but rather we can make it possible for ordinary citizens to have a more open political conversation amongst themselves. If I get up and I tell my Chinese students, I think you should be more free. Well, I'm a liberal journalism professor from New York. What am I supposed to say, right? I mean, that doesn't mean anything. If one of their peers says it, which has happened, the effect in the classroom of one Chinese student arguing with another Chinese student about how much freedom they should have is much more than anything they would take from me. And that's the conversation. To the degree that we want China to be more free, that's the conversation we should care about supporting. Yes, sir.
So your last answer largely anticipated the question I was originally going to ask, which was based on, I was in China 4 months ago, and I was astounded that everyone we would go to see, I had this image of the Great Firewall, and only I can access Google services in my hotel. Right. And everyone we would go to see had access to Google services using, you know, VPN. So, but it sounds like that's a relatively narrow slice.
Yes. So one of the things I ask my students to think of is to assume the firewall starts 10 kilometers in from the coast.
Yeah.
Because effectively, right, Beijing, Tianjin, Shanghai, all of Guangdong province, anyone there who's doing business with the West or anyone there who speaks English fluently probably has a VPN. There was a moment about a year and a half ago where China's like, well, we're cracking down on VPNs. That was right after the two meetings, the annual big political confab in Beijing. We're cracking down on VPNs. They went after the VPNs that were widely known, that worked well on phones, and that were free or cheap. If a VPN mostly worked on laptops or desktops, cost a lot of money, and was mostly used by businesses, traffic is unmolested, right? The day China wants to shut down all VPN traffic, they can. The fact that they don't do that tells you exactly what you want to know, which is they know that to be globally competitive, anyone you would be dealing with as an opposite number needs access to that, but they can't afford to have that spread to the broader public. And there's been a series of crackdowns on social media. They cracked down on Weibo, on their Twitter, to make it less political in 2013. And then in the following year, they let out a movie, an online documentary called Under the Dome about pollution in China, thinking it wouldn't spread because Weibo was how things spread quickly, right? Memes spread faster on Twitter than on Facebook. Because people don't have political conversations on Facebook because you don't want to talk politics with your friends and your family. What they hadn't bargained on was that there's no pro-pollution constituency to make having a conversation about pollution seem like the kind, oh, I don't want to bring up pollution around my aunt. She really loves pollution. So on WeChat, this thing gets 100 million views. I mean, it spreads on WeChat. People watch it. It gets 100 million views in 3 days, 200 million views in a week, and then they take it down. So their dilemma now is they're losing control. It's becoming more of a switch and less of a dial. What they'd like is to be able to turn it down until only the elites can see it. But what they're finding is when it's open even a little bit, it risks being open a lot. And that's what they're wrestling with right now. But I'm sorry, it sounded like you had a follow-on question.
My second question was just, and this is a little closer to my heart just because of what I do here, but to what extent do you see sort of intellectual property rights as a break or a governor on the expansion of companies like Xiaomi? Because at some point, they've got to go into other markets, yes. right? And so, and then yeah, they face the nationalistic backlash
yeah.
from,
yeah, yeah.
you know, whether it's Indian and yeah. intellectual property rights or somebody else.
I didn't, yeah, I didn't tell that. I didn't tell that part of the story, but in fact, and but it is in the book. They were shut down the first time they went to sell in India. They were shut down 4 days later. Ericsson enforced the patent. What they had done is they bought Qualcomm chips and said that buys us into the patent pool. And people were like, don't be ridiculous. Qualcomm's in the business of selling chips. Like, you either have to buy in or you have to contribute your own R&D. There is some of that convergence going on, but it is absolutely no accident that Xiaomi is not selling in either North America or Northern Europe, you know, Northwestern Europe. They're bargaining their way into it, but as the mobile phone industry goes global, the ability of a phone company to only operate in the Chinese market is somewhat limited. The IP problem is going to go away faster for hardware than software, because right now, as I mentioned before, the software firms face this choice of you can, if you operate in China, you're not well suited to go to the rest of the world. Now, if you were forced to not be a global company, as a consolation prize, being in the world's largest internet market is a pretty good second place. But it means that those companies that are not trying to spread globally will not be brought into the IP regime very quickly. But almost, I mean, one of the things that Xiaomi has kicked off is this sense that a Chinese phone company can be a global brand, not just a global white label hardware manufacturer, of which there were many, but really a well-known global brand. And that fact, that marketing fact, much more than legal norms, is bringing them into the IP regime, because they just can't do business outside the region without that. It will be slow, but it's happening. Software is because the Chinese government is enforcing a much larger gap on software between one side of the firewall and the other, it will be a longer time before it happens with software. Any questions? I think we have time for one more. Yes, sir.
Oh, hi, Professor. I actually went to one of your talks at Wenyu Shanghai. My question is, there's a long-held belief that there can be no innovation without meaningful political liberty. But then now you see like these amazing companies coming out of China yeah, that like leapfrog Silicon Valley by 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
So how do you reconcile those two facts?
I've never believed that, so I don't have any trouble reconciling it. It is wishful thinking to say that to have innovation, you have to have political liberty. I think the broader question is you have to have freedom to make mistakes. And what China has got now is a culture that says we fail fast and we move on. The clock speed of Chinese companies is very high. To the degree that there's liberty involved, Shenzhen is a very interesting story. There is a sign in the Shenzhen subway that says, again, my bad Mandarin, I apologize, but Lailo Joshi Shenzhen Ren, when you come here, then you're from here. When you come here, then you're a person of Shenzhen. That is not a typical Chinese view. I once asked one of my colleagues where she was from, and she told me where her grandfather's ancestral village was. And I said, well, that wasn't the question I thought I was asking, but I understand why you told me that. There is really a sense of rootedness in place. Shenzhen has a kind of freedom because you can relocate there and you're just accepted for being there. You're not viewed as an outsider. And that freedom makes Shenzhen a better ecosystem for innovation than other parts of China. It is a political freedom, lowercase p. It doesn't mean people are voting, but it does mean people have a higher degree of control over the choices they make in their life. The big question is the current crackdown. There's a current crackdown going on in the media environment, generally in China, which is quite ferocious. Will the removal of those freedoms as culture, any sort of cultural innovation becomes threatening to Beijing, will the removal of those freedoms slow down innovation? I'm betting that it does. It started with silly stuff. They banned a certain class of puns online precisely because of this stuff about people having conversations outside of the censor's hearing. They banned time travel on TV because too many people were using it to imagine a China where the Communist Party was not in charge. You know, and it seems like these are really like surgical incisions into the cultural environment, but they indicate a larger willingness to draw that circle in. So you need freedom to innovate. It doesn't have to be freedom to elect your local representative, but it does have to be freedom to say, I want to try something and I don't want to have to ask permission first. And China's starting to actually get weaker on that score. Literally every game, you could make Candy Crush 2, and every game to ship on a mobile phone inside China has to be approved by the state in advance. It's not just tell us the game as a story, tell us the game as characters, tell us the game as dog. Everything is now subjected to review. And I think that there are large sections of the software economy that are at risk of becoming less innovative simply because complying with those kinds of regulations reduces the freedom they have. I would like China to be more free. I see my students, half my students are PRC citizens. Most of them, they will make their lives in the PRC. I want them to have better lives than they could if they were in a less free environment. But I don't want to kid myself that you have to have that to be innovative. What you have to have is some kind of freedom. And the big question under the current regime is the reduction of cultural freedom going to go so far that it reins in innovation generally? It's already happening in gaming. It's happening in services. You could never get an Infosys, the Indian services company, in China because they couldn't export those services. But I don't think it comes down to you have to have political freedom to get any innovation. That would be a nice world if we had it. I don't, alas, think that that's the world we have. And I think I'm out of time. But thank you all. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for coming.